In this demo, we'll be taking a look at how to colorize a grayscale image using the adjustment layers and blending modes. Adjustment layers can be created by clicking the adjustment layer icon at the bottom of the layers palette. All adjustment layers are automatically created with a layer mask, which lets you paint in the area that you want the adjustment layer to affect. Adjustment layers can also have blending modes applied to them and can be clipped to other layers and groups with Ctrl+Alt+G. The first thing I want to do is generally decrease the contrast of this image as a whole. As I start layering various adjustment layers and blending modes, they each increase the contrast of the piece a little bit, and over time that can cause things to get a little bit over contrasty and blown out. So by opening my levels adjustment layer, I can simply adjust the output levels until I've pushed my blacks up towards a mid-tone gray and pulled my whites down towards a mid-tone lighter gray. After I've adjusted the contrast of the values, I want to infuse just a little bit of color to this so I'm not starting from a completely grayscale canvas. I'm thinking for this piece it would be fun to have more of a colder light source and warmer shadows, so I'm going to open up a color balance layer and just ever so slightly push my shadows towards a nice orangish color and my lights towards a little bit more of a cyan blue, and maybe experiment with my midtones a little bit. And that feels like a good place to start. Now at this point I have to decide if I want to flatten this down to a single layer. I think it's going to save me more time to keep my layers separated. The downside of this is I need a way to merge this levels and this color balance with all of my various character layers. The slower way is to use Ctrl+Alt+G to clip these adjustment layers to every single layer on the character, and then gradually go through and hit Ctrl+E to merge them together until we've applied those adjustments to the entire character. I've used this process a lot in the past, and it does work, but it's also very slow and time consuming. Thankfully, there are some things that can help. This doesn't come built into Photoshop, but there's a great little plugin called Layers Factory by Sergey Kritky that can save us a whole lot of time. If I simply select all the layers of my character, be sure to watch out for any existing clipping masks. I can use Layers Factory to mark target layers, select my adjustment layers, and then select clipped to targets and merge. And you can see this plugin automatically does what I was just doing by hand. It duplicates my adjustment layers, copies them over to the character, and merges them down, giving me a nice clean layer stack with my two adjustment layers applied to this character. This is a fairly cheap plugin, so I definitely recommend picking it up, but if you don't or can't for whatever reason, you can still do this process by hand. It doesn't take that long, it's just a little bit annoying. So now that we have a base laid down for our character, we can start looking into colorizing. For example, we could use a layer that's set to the color blending mode. This one isn't my favorite because it doesn't really account for different values and saturation levels very well. We could also use a multiply layer, which will apply color and darken, but keep in mind that the multiply layer is going to pretty significantly adjust our values, and we spent a lot of time in the painting stage getting these values correct, so although we will adjust them throughout this process, we also don't want to destroy all the hard work we did in our initial grayscale painting. Overlay is also another strong contender for adding color, as if you keep it in a more mid-range value, you can apply any kind of color you want, without really damaging the values that you've set up. I think for starting out, overlay is actually working quite well on the skin, so I'm gonna go find my face layer, create a new layer set to overlay, Ctrl+Alt+G to clip it to the layer that I've painted the face and hair on, and then I can simply start painting with my round brush to begin adding color to this. Now this layer does have the hair on it as well, so I'm going to need to account for that in my painting, but I also have some of my hair on a separate layer in this image, so I'll need to keep my color preserved on my color picker and copy that over to the second hair layer. In this case, I'm not entirely sure what color I want for the hair, so I'm going to make another layer set to overlay, paint something down to get the hair blocked in, and then I'm going to start messing around with hue saturation until I find a nice color that I like. I'm quite liking this deep dark brown as a starting point, but I now have the problem where I don't have that color in my color picker, so I can't really copy this over to the second hair layer. This is an easy fix. If I just set the blending mode back to normal, I can eyedrop that color, set the blending mode to overlay, make a new layer set to overlay on top of the second hair layer, and paint in like so. We also have a third hair layer in this case, and I'll need to do the same thing there. listed as back hair in my layer stack. And there we go. We've got the beginnings of some color happening. Now, there's a bit of a problem here where we're getting what I call kind of a colorized effect. Like when you see those old black and white photos that have been colorized and they look like they're in color, but it doesn't quite look correct. This is due to a lack of subtlety and transition between the lights and the shadows. If we take a look at the face, and especially turn off this veil layer, we can see that we have exactly the same hue and color across the entirety of the face, whether it's from the nose to the lips to the cheek, or even rolling into the shadows. We're not getting any change or adjustment in the colors, and that's causing us a bit of a problem where it's not really looking realistic anymore. This is usually the issue that beginners run into when they first start colorizing their images, and the solution is simply to invest a little bit more time and use some more flexible blending modes and adjustment layers to add that variety and interest to your colors. For example, we know there's going to be some amount of local color difference on the face. The lips are probably going to be a little bit darker and more reddish. We might even have a somewhat similar effect on the nose, though not quite as strong. We don't want her to look like she's drunk. But then we also need to consider what we're going to do with the lights versus the shadows. So in this case, I've decided that I want to have a situation where I've got a slightly colder light source. So we've got a cold light coming from the upper left, and then some kind of warmer fill light coming from the opposite side to fill in our shadows. We're missing that separation between the two at the moment, so we'll need to push the colors of our light and shadows in the direction that they need to go. In this case, I can grab another multiply layer, maybe just use a soft brush, and start pushing a slightly stronger orangish tone into my shadows. This might also creep into the midtones just a little bit. And then to push my lights a little bit colder, I might grab sort of a light blue color set to overlay, and begin gently brushing that color in on the light side of the face. Now, she's getting a little bit too pale here, I think, so I want to pull down the overall value of the skin so that the blue light color can really shine through. In this case, I can simply make another multiply layer, paint in, and adjust the value until it's looking correct. There's a lot of push and pull like this throughout the colorizing process. Don't be discouraged if it takes you a few tries to figure out exactly the right combination of things to make this work. It's a long and experimental process. We have a similar issue going on with the hair right now, where the color of the hair isn't really adjusting at all as it moves from the shadows to the highlights. We can follow basically the same process as before, so I'm going to start with my front hair, create a multiply layer. Now we have a bit of an issue where the front layer of hair is overlapping the back layer, and the highlights are kind of crossing over both. So I've created an overlay layer to add in this blue highlight, and I want it to be a seamless transition between those two different layers of hair. Since I've painted this just on one layer, I can move it down, clip it to the front layer of hair, Ctrl J to duplicate, drag it down to the head layer, then clip it to get a nice seamless transition.
Hey, did you know that this lesson is actually from our Digital Painting Fundamentals course on Proko.com? In this course, you can learn how to rapidly improve your painting skills from instructors like John Nijmeister, Jeremy Vickery, and Marco Bucci, and several other pro artists. They'll cover the basics like how to create your own brushes, things you can do with layers, playing with shadow and light, and then move up to other lessons like imitating different materials and learning color theory. You can improve your digital skills now at proko.com/digitalpainting.
So we've got a couple pieces going in a good direction, but this isn't the only method that we can use for colorizing. Now we come to my all-time favorite, gradient map. It looks a bit confusing at first, but trust me, it's actually pretty simple. Gradient map is a value-based adjustment, which replaces values in your images with colors you select on nodes. If I open a gradient map, you can see that it's a simple black to white gradient and is converting my image to grayscale. If I place a node at 50% by clicking underneath the gradient, all values of 50% in my image will be replaced with that node's color. What's more, the gradient map will automatically fade between my various nodes and apply those in-between colors to the corresponding values in the image. Did you follow all that? Don't worry, it's hard to explain, but it's actually pretty easy to use, so let's take a closer look. So I'm gonna try colorizing the headdress really quick here. I'm gonna hit D to reset my color palette, create a gradient map, use Ctrl-Alt-G to clip it to the headdress, and now I can set the nodes of color on this gradient map to whatever I need them to be, and have them transition between different colors from the shadows to the lights. So using this gradient map, I can get a pretty nice transition from warmer shadows into a sort of neutral yellowish bone color, then pushing towards blue for the highlights. I can slide these nodes around until I get exactly the right balance of color that I want. Now, you'll notice as I turn this on and off that this gradient map layer is pretty severely affecting my values, so I'm going to want to set it to a blending mode. We can try just setting it to color, but I'm also going to scroll through the various blending modes to see which one feels correct. This gradient map is overall working well for the headdress, but I do want the color and value to shift slightly as it moves away from the center and towards the tips of the antlers. I might be able to get away with just using hue saturation in this case. If I create a new hue saturation layer, my idea is that they're going to start pushing towards more of a bluish color, but also get much darker and less saturated. I can then simply click on the mask next to this hue saturation layer, press Ctrl+I to invert, and then use a brush to paint in where I want that adjustment layer to be affecting. And that's actually about exactly what I want, so mission accomplished. I want to be sure that I don't get too heavy into really refining these colors or adding any details until I've got a complete picture of what I want my image to be, is if I get too heavy into rendering these or adjusting any tiny subtleties, I might find that the colors as a whole don't really fit together when I'm finished. So I'm going to keep this basic for now and focus on just the colorizing process, and then refine it with more subtlety later. On this base character layer, I have a lot of different materials all baked into the same layer, so I can't quite use clipping masks the same way I did on the other pieces of the character, but that's still not really a problem, as I can use the same techniques and just brush in by hand where I need these various colors to go. So I've painted in the base purple as a whole, and then I can simply select a lighter tone for the skin and the light fur on the shoulder that's also part of this layer. She also has some belts and this little hanging satchel here, and I'll definitely want to differentiate that from the purple underneath to avoid that colorized look. I think in this case, try to keep generally the same value, but pushing them towards more of a neutral brownish tone should work pretty well. Another useful tip, if your character is made up of a whole bunch of different layers, and especially once you start adding in all these adjustment layers, your layer stack can get pretty big pretty quick. If I'm looking for a specific layer, I can hit V to select the Move tool, then Ctrl+click any area in my image, and it will automatically try to select the layer that I've clicked on. And in this case, I was looking for this little bit of fabric draping from the shoulder, so it did its job perfectly. Another handy thing about gradient maps is that if you ever have the same material, you can simply copy and paste your existing gradient map to the new layer. I have this skull that's sitting on her shoulder down here, so I can take the gradient map that I used for the headdress and simply apply it to that skull. Another easy way to duplicate layers is to simply hold Alt, then click, drag, and drop, and you'll create an exact copy of the layer that you dragged. I can then hit Ctrl+Alt+G to clip it to this skull, and it did exactly what I wanted to do. I can then just open up a levels adjustment layer and tweak my values until the gradient map is hitting all the right color notes for that material. I also want to use a gradient map for the earpiece that's sitting over the headdress. I'm imagining kind of a rusty bronzish color that's also kind of teetering towards a green, like it oxidized a little bit. And I feel like that's going to be easier to achieve with the control that I get from the gradient map. I feel like that's working for the base color of the earpiece, but I want to get that oxidization in there. And in this case, it's really easy to do with just a second gradient map. So I'm going to set up another gradient map and try to get that sort of greenish blue effect of really old coppers and bronzes. Something like that will probably work pretty well. Now that I've got the second gradient map set up, I can set it to a blending mode like hue, click on the layer mask next to the adjustment layer, Ctrl+I to invert, and then grab a brush with some nice gritty texture to it, and just start painting in that effect a little bit by hand. Because I've set the blending mode to hue, it's only affecting the colors of the layer underneath and not changing the values at all. This is perfect for the kind of effect I'm trying to get in this case. I think my colors overall are working here now, but it's feeling a little disjointed from the rest of the image. So I'm going to pull down the saturation just a little bit with a hue saturation layer. And I also want to push some of my colored lighting just a little bit. So I'm going to create an overlay layer, push the shadows a little bit more towards warm colors, and then push these highlights a little bit more towards some colder colors. And that's a pretty subtle adjustment, but you can see it sort of brings the whole thing together. And that's the power of these blending modes and adjustment layers, is you have so much flexibility to just subtly push your colors around to where they need to be. For the draping beads, I have a bit of an interesting problem, as I want to create a consistent feeling of light and form across the strands as a whole, while also having a lot of different colors and values on all the different beads. So for this, I'm going to start by trying to establish just my overall forms, pushing my lights a little bit lighter, and getting a nice dark wrapping with the overlay layer. And with this overlay layer, I've established sort of the overall light and form. And now I can use something like multiply to add in all those different colored beads. I want to be careful with the values and colors I choose and make sure that they're still reading clearly on top of everything else underneath. But once I've established that overall value, it's actually pretty easy to go in and just add in some various colors and details with a multiply layer. I do have a second layer with all these headdress beads as well though, and I'll need to be sure to take that into account. So I'll just control click to find that layer, create a new layer set to multiply, and then I can start painting in some of these various colors. And if I need to, I can also create an overlay layer, put it underneath my multiply layer, and reestablish some of that larger light and form. I'd also like some of these beads to have a slightly more pearly effect to them, and I think a lighten layer is gonna serve me really well here. The essence of that effect is that it really kind of picks up on all different colors and kinds of light from all directions. So if I make a new layer set to lighten, and then maybe grab some nice greens and purples, I can push the values of my shadows upwards a little bit and also infuse a lot of really interesting color and textures. Lighten is one of my favorite blending modes, as it interacts with existing colors in some really interesting ways, and you can get some really lovely effects out of it. I do think the adjustments I made with Lighten pushed my values maybe a little bit too far, so I'm just going to tweak the opacity of that layer until it's looking like it's in a better spot. And then I might even create another adjustment layer set to overlay, just to push and pull my values and colors around a little bit. And with that, I think the draping beads are looking pretty good, so I'm going to repeat that process on the necklaces that are draping over her chest. I think this is overall going in a good direction. One thing that's kind of standing out to me is this big patch of fur on her shoulder. I feel like it's just a little too boring and simple in terms of color, so I'm going to actually use my bone gradient map again, and see if I can push that to be a little bit more interesting of a texture. And even just dropping that same gradient map directly on top added a lot of nice interest. I do want to be sure it's not affecting the rest of the sleeve and everything else though. So I'm going to click on the mask, press Ctrl I to invert it, and then paint in these areas by hand. I might then adjust the opacity just a little bit, and I think pushing this fur a little bit more towards a brownish tone is actually fitting in better with the rest of the character. I also have to apply that to the fur on the other side. So again, I'm just going to hold Alt to drag that gradient map to create a copy, clip it to my shaman layer, and then use my brush tool to paint in the mask so it begins to affect that fur over there. And at this point, I think we're starting to go in a good direction. There's definitely a lot of subtlety that we'll want to refine, but even if I just start pushing my background in the direction that I had planned for the overall color palette, pushing my shadows a little bit more warm and my highlights more towards blue, we can see that this is actually starting to look like a pretty decent image. There's still a lot of subtleties we can adjust and ways that we can improve this, but it's a really good base layer, and we've utilized a lot of different blending modes and adjustment layers to really speed up our process and help us to get some interesting textures and effects.
Adjustment layers are a very useful tool for a digital painter, but there's a lot of other tools that you can use to enhance your digital work, and you can learn all that in the course over at proko.com/digitalpainting. We've even got a summer sale going on for a few more weeks. Just use the code SUMMERSALE to save 20% on any course. You can even bundle part 1 and 2 of the Digital Fundamentals course for even more savings. So don't miss out. That's at proko.com/digitalpainting.